brother and friend, Professor Juma Shabani. This session will be sharing with you our thoughts on an agenda for fostering sustainable, the key word there is sustainable, a partnership in teaching and research between universities in Finland, especially those within the purview of Finland University, the three universities, as well as universities in Africa. We're talking about Global University Network for Innovation, GUNI. I like to first introduce GUNI, the Global University Network for Innovation. The network was established following the UNESCO 1998 World Conference on Higher Education, the Apostle Shabani made allusion to. One of the resolutions of that conference is to stimulate innovation in higher education all over the world, that universities were not paying enough attention to innovation. So UNESCO, as part of the plan of action, initiated a move to establish an organization that would be encouraging and promoting innovation in higher education. So, by 2001, GUNI was established. GUNI has its headquarters in Barcelona, Spain, and because UNESCO was part of triggering its establishment, UNESCO is a major partner of GUNI. What is the key goal of GUNI? By its mission, the organization is to contribute to the renewal of visions, missions, and policies of higher education across the world. And by the way, if you see how we have crafted our acronym, GUNI, if it is the traditional way of doing it, if you are doing it in caps, that's in capital letters, it will be capital GUNI, because we want to be innovative. So the I there is put in lowercase. That's an example of wanting to be innovative. The objectives of GUNI, as we have them there, but let me highlight a couple of them. One is to bridge the gap between developing and developed countries in the field of higher education. And as you can see, you have higher education management as one of the flagship programs, the University of Tampere, and it will show that your program is at the heart of the objectives of GUNI. And this is done through fostering capacity, building capacity, the North and the South. GUNI is also promoting the exchange of resources, human and material resources, innovative ideas and experiences. And there is a major push in the last couple of years in the area of enhancing social responsibility of higher education. Global University Network is a global network, and we have network clusters in different regions of the world. You have GUNI, North America, GUNI, all of those you can see on the screen, and then you have GUNI Africa. GUNI Africa was established at the same time that the GUNI Global, you know, was established in 2001. By the way, the other networks, you know, follow. GUNI Africa was the first to be established, and we have our headquarters in the first and only presidential library in the whole of Africa. That's the Olusegun Obasanjo Presidential Library, which is based in Abeokuta, in Nigeria. We want to make bold, we want to, you know, beat our chest to say that GUNI Africa is one of the leading, you know, the most productive of the different networks within GUNI. We have a few success stories that I wish to share with you before moving to the substance of the partnership that we are hoping to share the agenda, you know, with you today. We facilitate export of education to and from Africa. And we work with partners, with our partners, notably UNESCO, the European Union, and the Association of African Universities, to conduct annual international conference on quality assurance in higher education in Africa. Professor Shabani, in an earlier presentation, you know, told you that these conferences are highly sought after. And we do not just run the conference, we have the conference bundled with several other events, notably the workshop. So we have a theme, apart from speakers coming to share their experiences with us, we run workshops to build capacity of participants, usually higher education providers, managers of higher education across Africa and outside of it, ministers of education, student leaders, and all of that. We have also partnered with UNESCO. Professor Shabani also made the connection of this to establish and successfully run a virtual institute for higher education in Africa. We preface this with the establishment of the Higher Education Virtual Institute for Higher Education Pedagogy. And how did we even start this? When I was appointed Executive Secretary of the National Universities Commission, in charge of all universities in Nigeria, I found, because I've been in the Nigerian university system for ever and a day, and I knew that many of our colleagues who are in disciplines other than education do not have any pedagogic training. Well, that's as expected. But we know that if you kit them with pedagogic training, they will be better teachers. So people in medicine, in engineering, in law, in history, all of these people who are PhDs that we need to, you know, help them. So we set up this virtual institute based on some materials that Professor Shabani, you know, and leading the team prepared 2 or 3 years before. So what did we find? Our first module was on how to teach large classes. And we had almost like about 3,000 professors from different disciplines participate in that 1 month-long training. After that, we mounted a module on how to use new technologies for teaching and learning. And we found like 6,000, you know, participate 1 month-long. And we rolled out several other modules. We ended up with 12 modules. So for a whole year, we had a nice cycle of training for the participants. And one is happy to know that because we just didn't offer the programs, we followed up with evaluating them. We followed up with asking them how they have applied the knowledge and skills that they've learned in the virtual institute in the day. So we found that they were applying this and pedagogy significantly improved. I just go through this. These are some other of our success stories. We have trained over 1,500 quality assurance practitioners from all over Africa. Those who are involved in quality assurance, either in agencies or in institutions, we run training programs for them. We are delighted that that training is impacting very positively in quality delivery of higher education in Africa. We've also stimulated the establishment of about 9 national quality assurance agencies. And as Professor Shabani mentioned, we have started a series on quality assurance in higher education, where we are showing good practices. I want to share the URL, the website of different things with you. How do you, as a vice chancellor, or rector, or president of a university, run your university on a very lean budget? So we have a module on that. What are the successful practices? What are the practices of successful rectors? So we looked at rectors, vice chancellors all over Africa who have been successful, and we asked them to share with us their experience. We have all of this is documented in that video. How do you run a university that is strike-free? We run into the headwind of strikes occasionally in a number of universities in Africa. So we have put a module together, you know, on that. One other module is the attributes of successful university teachers. So we asked students from all over Africa, those teachers that you label good quality, what are those things that they exhibited? And we documented that. I also went to teachers that students said they were good. So, Mr. Teacher or Mr. Professor, or Madam Professor, what are those things that we're doing that students love you so much? So we're able to document this. Let me move on to share with you what the attributes, or rather some characteristics of the African higher education system. We have, as I speak, over 2,600 higher education institutions made up of universities, polytechnics, and colleges of education. About 7 million students are enrolled in the higher education system in Africa and growing. The professor of higher education management mentioned about massification. So we have a large number angling to go into higher education. Let me probably explain why we're having that high, large number now. In 1999, 2000, UNESCO came up with the Higher Education for All program. So, in Nigeria, for instance, the president of the country then said, oh, let's have all the students come to school. So when you now have many students coming to basic education, 12 years down the road, by way of a 12-year secondary education program, you have a large number now ready to go into higher education. So that's going to continue. So whereas the spaces available, the current capacities of the higher education system is limited. So those others who are not able to get spaces are going to Europe, North America, Asia, for their higher education. So, of all the regions of the world today, the region that has the highest number of candidates, of students, secondary school products, going outside Africa to look for higher education are Africans. We have about a fifth of our students enrolled for science, engineering, and technology, and the contribution to global literature is rather low, about 3%. There's linguistic diversity in Africa. The historical route is the Benin Conference, when Europe came, put up a map of Africa, and then they started dividing Africa, the Anglophone, oh, we're going to take Ghana, Nigeria, and all of this. The French will say, I'm going to take this. So we now have Africa that is carved into these linguistic zones. The Anglophone, the Francophone, the Lusophone, and the Arabophone. So all the four phones, you know, are there. In Africa. Let's move quickly to teaching in African universities. We have a lot of success stories to share with you. And of course, there are a few handicaps. Most of, when I use the word most, I'm now looking at about 75% of professors in African universities are well steeped, well soaked in their content knowledge. They know their chemistry. They know their mathematics. They know their education. We are very good people who are skilled teachers. Or rather, who are skilled in the knowledge of the content that they want to teach. Very many of them. And our lecturers are committed. They're very committed. And when they have some challenge with their welfare, I mean, they don't hesitate to strike and extract the commitment from government. So our students are also very committed. Our students are well motivated to learn. Indeed, if you took a student from an African university or an African secondary school to a European secondary school or American secondary school, you find that the student will do very well. It's giving an ambience of better facilities and better teaching. And one of the success stories, I think, is also about the language of instruction. So if you come to a Nigerian university, come to a Ghanaian university, it's the official language that is used, regardless of the local language that the student may. We have a few handicaps. About half of the classrooms are poorly resourced. And it's a matter of massification. Since you have a large number coming in, especially in the Francophone setting, as Professor Shabani mentioned. So, a lecture room that is meant to take in about 30, because you are driving a large number of secondary school leavers to come in, you now have to crowd 60 into that. So the resources are not able to service that number of students there. And many of the lecturers have low pedagogical skills. That's why we introduced the lecturers in the first case. And then technology, yes, technology is is improving, but many of the lecturers, especially the old ones, are still very tardy in catching up with technology. And that's understandable. And that's, I think, is a global phenomenon, where the older professors are not too keen in getting to learn new skills in the use of technology. And we have challenges with the evaluation, too. What about the Finnish university? We've taken some little pain to look at Finland. And we're happy, very happy to know that Finland is doing very well in education. Most education indices in Finland, especially teacher education, education management, Finland is almost like number one. Countries want to see how you are doing it. And that's why one of the other agenda of why we're here, I mean, to see how you do your teacher education program, to see how we can partner so as to learn from you, learn from us, and together we'll see how we can enhance the delivery of education at all levels, especially at the higher education level. So substance knowledge, as content knowledge, you know, very good, and your universities are well resourced, but the traditional teaching methods are still prevalent. And that's also like a global phenomenon. In other words, the old professor teaches as he was taught. And this is a recent study by Jami Samuel that was commissioned by the government of Finland to do a survey of higher education in this country. So we're thinking of setting up this project with you, which is Finland University, Finn Uni, Guinea Africa Pedagogy Project. And we're proposing that the mission, the thrust of that project should be on enhancing the quality of higher education delivery in Africa and Finland through improved pedagogic practices and cross-border export of educational services. These are some other objectives that we're proposing. We think the project should sharpen the pedagogical skills of teachers in partner Africa and Finnish universities. That is the Finn Uni Group, three universities, to see how we work with you and relevant universities in Africa that we have affiliation with to improve the pedagogical skills. And by improving the pedagogical skills, there's a logic. By improving the pedagogical skills of teachers will be able to deliver the curriculum better. And the quality of graduates will also improve. If the quality of graduates improve, the end point of that logic is that the employability, the impact of graduates in the economy will also enhance. So that's a change which we think this project can help to pull forward. And we're looking at the education export, staff and students, and the strengthen teacher preparation programs in the universities that are within that partnership. And they want to be able to let this partnership provide good examples of best practices of teacher education across the disciplines. I'd like to reflect on a project we did in Nigeria. When I became Executive Secretary of the National Universities Commission, I found that the professorate was aging. The very good professors who delivered their content in an exemplary fashion were failing, and were leaving the system. And we had younger lecturers who were not as endowed coming. So before these, if you like, aging professors leave, we then decided to document the way they were teaching their concepts. So we conducted a preliminary survey which found out the difficult topics that students have. They find it difficult to learn in the different disciplines. Let's take economics. So as economics graduates of different universities, what are those topics in economics that you found difficult to learn? And they give us those topics. Now, in your university, who are those professors in economics that you found to be really, really good? And then they find this. So we did that across all the universities in Nigeria, and then for every course, we got the top 10 topics that students found difficult. And we took three professors that were found to be good. And then we went to those universities and recorded those professors A number of those professors are now dead. Well, a number of, but all of them are alive. They are alive in the tapes that we, that we provided. And we made this free to all the universities in Nigeria. So a young professor, a young lecturer now comes in to teach economics. And he is now encountering this difficult topic. So that's going to go far. He only needs to drag out that that CD and use it as part of his teaching resource. So we think that we can work on this, we can achieve this. And we think that this project can also, as part of its objectives, for us to conduct joint research in teaching and learning and to organize conferences together, organize workshops together as part of this partnership. We're looking at some phases for the project. The first thing we did in Africa under the leadership of Professor Shabani is to do a needs assessment. So we can't just sit and just pontificate and be conjectural and say, oh yes, teachers, we need the following pedagogical skills. Who told us that? You cannot. So what we did was to ask the teachers, by way of a survey, what are those skills that you are finding difficulty with? And they listed this. So on the basis of the skills, on the basis of the results of this assessment, was when we then developed modules. Teachers told us that they were not too, most of them said, oh, they are not too familiar with the processes of curriculum development. Or not too familiar with the processes of setting multiple choice questions, evaluating students. And so we developed modules around this. Let me make a mention of a number of the modules we developed. Teaching large classes. How to teach the young, the fresh student. The use of new technologies for teaching and learning, evaluation of teaching and learning, curriculum development, guidance and counseling in education. How do you take care of the needs of the special student? How do you, a number of the modules were then developed based on the needs assessment. We think that if we are going to do this project together, because we have the expertise, we also have the expertise, the idea is now for us to partner, to share our expertise, and develop some program that will be suitable for your context and for our context. And so, we are looking at our going further on our virtual institute to have what we call the FinUni Uni Africa Virtual Institute for Education Pedagogy. We ran this very successfully. When we scale up from a Nigerian setting to the African setting, we were almost for 2 years, about 2 years, we were running this project, and we were running, delivering these modules to teachers in the whole of Africa. We had about 10,000 teachers in our education system in Africa, mainly about 90% and 10% from other countries of the world who connected to the platform. We are also thinking that we will have a workshop, some workshops to coincide with the annual conferences, and maybe develop some courses for credit, and then we monitor thereafter. So, proposed methodology, and we'll propose some methodologies here, which will be the management. We have some proposals here that we have joint partners in terms of directing, coordinating, and running the program. How do we get funds for this program? It has to be by partnership of the consortium of Uni Africa, of the Association of African Universities, of AFRICOAN, of FinUni, of universities that are going to be participating in the educational export, and also donors. Because a good project, we have no doubt whatsoever that we want to get funding support from this consortia of organizations. You know, we're looking at teaching and also research. On the matter of research partnership, we have a few objectives that we are proposing here. If you are partnering with FinUni in the area of research, the objectives could include collaboration with African universities, Finnish universities, for the purpose of solving problems that are common to both Africa and Finland and the rest of the world, and then to strengthen research capacity of scholars in the two areas, the region, and the country. And then for the also provide empirical data for solving problems that are global, environment, and other related things. And for us to publish scholarly materials such as books and journals that relate to the themes that we may all have jointly put together. On the design of the research partnership, because the pedagogy one is the primary thing, we are putting research one as secondary, and we are hoping over time to jointly develop a template for the research partnership. But for concluding remarks, I'd like to underscore the importance of pedagogy in university teaching and the fact that Finland, University of Tampere, has very good tradition in pedagogical practices, delivering courses in pedagogy, higher education management. We see this partnership to be that's an outlook to be tremendously beneficial for Africa, for Finland, and for the rest of the world. And we cannot wait. I think immediately after here, we should just keep running. So we see a very viable partnership that is ready to kick off. And, thank you.